Have you had an encounter with Mr. Tall, Dark, and Scary? Well, if so, I want to hear about it. And so does everyone else. So go on, send me an email with all the details. You can send it to contact@BuckeyeBigfoot.com. Well, hello there, everyone, and welcome back. Or if it's your first time, welcome to Buckeye Bigfoot. Now, tonight's journey down into Sasquatch Valley is going to take us into Texas, where our submitter, James, has a grandmother that lives there, and where it seems a four-year-old mistook a Bigfoot for a movie star. Now, James has written into us before, but this one is a new and recent encounter. Now, listen, the horses are outside waiting for us. Go grab your snackage, top up your drink, and let's get in the saddle and move on down the trail into Sasquatch Valley, where, if we're lucky, we will encounter the world's most elusive cryptid. Are you ready? Me too. Let's go. Greetings for the third time. I assure you, I am not trying to steal the spotlight. However, what I have to offer you is something I believe you'll find very interesting. To start off, I took the week of spring break off from work and went to visit my grandmother. I always call her my Grammy Gam. She lives on a patch of land located in Lytle, Texas. If you're not too familiar, it's on the more southwest side of San Antonio. When I got there, I was pleasantly surprised to see my elder brother visiting as well. With him was his adorable little four-year-old daughter, whom we'll call Violet. On my grandmother's property, she raises horses and has four dogs, one of them being a Great Dane. And it's perfect, since Great Danes need a lot of outdoor time in a spacious environment. And that's exactly the kind of land my grandma owns. Specifically, it's very wooded, but with a butt-ton of cacti. A lot of the residents who own land in Lytle tend to have a bunch of woods and cactus in their property. Now, funny story. Back in my youth, my elder brother and I would venture out into Grammy Gam's woods, find a nice sturdy stick, and slay the army of cactus and capture the general. Well, or so we called it. Essentially, we would find a nice big group of cactus and repeatedly beat the ever-loving crap out of them and get all the juices and little prickly spines in places where it would be almost impossible to remove. I remember one day, me and my brother were out hunting the captain of the pricks, as we called it. And yes, I understand how childish that was. Well, my brother stabbed a large piece of cacti and threw it in my vicinity, which happened to be my groin. I'll tell you, I've not been more of a baby than when that happened. It took me a week to get all those little spines out. Anyway, enough of the different segues. For old time's sake, my brother and I, along with Violet, decided to venture into the woods again. Obviously, not to slay the captain of the pricks, since little Violet was present, but to stroll and to have a good time. Now, Violet here is a pretty smart child for her age. She picks up on social cues and can name all of her favorite animals. Now, her favorite animal always changes each time she sees a new one, and this time it was horses. Her favorite horse was a black stallion that my grandmother had picked up, and his name is Harley. Now, Harley is a big boy, about 500 to 600 pounds, and just shy of 6'2". Grandma would saddle up Harley and let Violet ride on his back. Well, when we got to the tree line, there was Harley, munching on some grass and some hay scattered around on the ground. When Violet saw him, her eyes widened with excitement, and she ran up to him and hugged his right leg. That was so adorable. Now, at the tree line, it's like you're standing in front of a wall, except, of course, it's made of trees. But if you go a little deeper, you will be met with a small creek about 7 feet across, and it's about 4 feet deep. It's a decently sized creek, and it moves gracefully, not too fast and not too slow. While my brother was with Violet and Harley, I went to the creek. It was nice to see that little old creek once more, to smell the water and the flowers. It was just very beautiful. When I came to appreciate its beauty, I saw a wee little rabbit just lying there. It wasn't moving, but it didn't look like it was sleeping either. Perhaps it was dead. I do remember seeing Coyote on her property a handful of times. She always warned us about them, not to be alone for too long because they'll think we're prey, all alone for the taking. Well, whatever the case, I just continued to venture deeper. There's a certain amount of distance I could cover before hitting a long fence line that separated Grandma's property from the other neighbors. I hit the fence line, and I knew I dared not trespass. Everyone I know who owns property in Lytle carries a shotgun or a rifle, so I was smart enough to not even think about it. It eventually went dark, so we went back to the house to grab some grub and hit the sack. It was about 8 or 9 in the evening when I woke up to the sounds of coyotes going absolutely berserk. They were barking and hollering out. Typically, from my hunting experience, predators don't make noise while they're on the hunt, so this was real strange behavior on their part. That went on for about 13 minutes before they died down. Grandma was asleep during that whole noise fest, but Violet was awakened and started crying. So I turned on the television, and I went to a movie channel that was featuring Star Wars. We watched for a good 45 minutes before she dozed off again. In the morning, we were awakened to a door knock with heavy pounding. My grandmother answered with caution and was greeted with our neighbor, David. Now, I have known David since I was in the 5th grade, and I have always called him Crazy Dave, 'cause he was trigger happy, if you know what I mean. Well, Dave looked real upset at my grandma, saying we were trespassing on his land and causing all the coyotes to go ballistic and to make all that ruckus. I butted in and told him we were all inside when we heard the coyotes, too. Now, for reference, remember that long fence line that I told you about? Well, the land on the other side of that fence belongs to Dave. He said that he knew it was one of us because he saw one of us, claiming that he knew it because he saw a tall figure in his tree line. My brother is a modest 6'3", while I'm a minuscule 5'9". You know, God really is unfair sometimes. So anyway, we denied it again, and Dave followed up with, "Next time I see ya, I'm only giving one warning shot." Then he left. As the day progressed, we helped Grandma with the horses and gathered some firewood for a bonfire. While my brother was assisting Grandma with the hay bales for the horses, I took Violet out to help grab some sticks for the fire. Since there were countless trees, sticks were all over the place. Heck, I even found a couple sticks impaling some cacti from when my brother and I were just kids. But then all of a sudden, I found a jawbone. It looked very fresh because I remember still seeing the gums were still moist, and there was reflecting light off of its pink hue. I saw Violet going to try to pick it up, but I pushed her away from it. Something mean had to have gotten to whatever this poor critter used to be. I tried to ignore it as we continued to pick up sticks, but as I went on, I felt a familiar feeling of being watched. I think Violet felt it too, because she started saying that someone was following us. Well, I turn around in 1 second, and Violet starts making her way to the fence. I drop my sticks and quickly grab her arm and say, "No." She says, "But Uncle, it's Baca." I get really confused, and I said, "What?" So she said again, "It's Baca." She starts waving, and then all of a sudden, I hear a low, deep hum or grunt that sounded like it was saying hello to Violet. When I heard that, I tried pulling Violet away, but then whatever made that noise made an angry grunting noise and pounded on the ground. I picked Violet up, and I ran away as fast as I could. I make it out of the tree line, and I'm all out of breath. Big Brother sees me and asks, "What's the problem?" I just shrugged it off, and I told him that I got a spider on my arm. So he laughs at me and calls me a scared baby, telling me that Violet's got a bigger pair than me. Well, I'll let you interpret that. By the time we finished, it was high noon, and we went inside and grabbed some lunch. I'm looking back at what happened, and I'm getting vibes of what happened in 2000, and I'm not sure I like it too much, especially with Violet around. It's different because I was with Joel when that happened in 2000. But my brother is different. He will doubt you and gaslight you into thinking you're crazy. And with what could have happened with little Violet, I couldn't bear to admit what happened. Now it was about 6 in the evening, and we were having dinner. Grandma has a patio with a glass sliding door. We like to eat facing the woods and watch the horses and whatever else might be out there. We're all eating when all of a sudden Violet goes, "Ooh, baka, baka!" While Grandma and my brother are confused, I'm sitting with my food just hanging out of my mouth. They ask her what baka is, and she does the thing that Chewbacca does from Star Wars, kind of makes the noise that he makes, or tried to. Grandma asks if she saw a man outside, and Violet nods with excitement. Grandma then gets up from the kitchen table, calls her neighbor that lives 3 miles down, and tells him to bring his Smith & Wesson lever action. Grandma grabbed the 12-gauge and waited for the neighbor, whom we'll just call Justin. 10 minutes later, he arrives. He walked in with his rifle. He sees us, and he asks if we know how to shoot. I obviously said yes, but I'm getting flashbacks from 2000. My big brother did too, because he's ex-military. And just a fun side fact about me. My dad and everyone on my mom's side was either in the Marine Corps or Coast Guard. So Justin gets 2 more firearms from his truck. He hands me another lever-action rifle and gives my brother an SKS. Justin had brought his daughter along for extra firepower, but with my brother and I, we should be set. So we asked if it was okay to have her watch Violet. She agreed, and we set off. Before we left, Violet asked us not to hurt Baca. Justin replied, "Don't worry, we're just going to pay him a visit." When we got to the tree line, we found another jawbone, only this time it was more bloody than pink. We saw what looked like a paw hit the ground in front of us. We look up and we find a mutilated coyote up in a tree. My God, that was a morbid sight. Its spine was hanging out like it had been pulled from its body. We progress deeper into the woods where the creek rests and see that the fence that separates Grandma's land from Dave's land had been trampled down. And we also find mud streaks, like someone or something slipped while walking. Just moments later, we hear Crazy Dave cursing and yelling, and then he's firing shots. When he did, we heard an unholy roar. It sounded mean. And it sounded angry. Shot after shot, we grew worried. Grandma said, "That's David. He sounds like he's in trouble." While everyone was focused on Crazy Dave, I'm over here getting crazy PTSD from you-know-what back in 2000, so I start getting sick to my stomach. When I got a hold of myself, we heard rustling in the bushes on the other side of the creek. We all froze and dared not to breathe. My grandmother, she's a bit savage, you know. When we saw a large, dark brown figure emerge from the brush, she didn't even think to check if it was a human or not. She fired both shells of her shotgun and reloaded quicker than Clint Eastwood. Before she could fire again, this thing began to roar and nearly caused us to go deaf. And we all know, and by all, I mean you, Miss Nance, and all of your fellow listeners tuning in, we all know this is Bigfoot once again. After it finished roaring, it sped off into the woods, and we have not heard of that thing since. Now fast forward to the day after. Justin patches up the fence. He checks on Mr. Two Screws Loose on the other side, a.k.a. Crazy Dave, and he makes sure that Grammy Gam is all right. Everything seemed good for the time being, so he takes off. But before he did, his daughter was telling me that Violet was saying some weird stuff while we were away. She was talking about how Baca was calling to her, and she wanted to go be with Baca. It was really crazy, and I really didn't want to think too much about it. I didn't know what to make of it, and I know I didn't want to see those things again. Now, after all that drama was done and over with, my brother took off to go back home. I sat my grandma down just to make sure she was doing all right. She said she was fine, just that she hadn't seen him in a while. Him, I asked. Yes, him, she replied. She called him the man from the fog. And she then told me a story of when she was just a little girl back in 1956. Oh my, here came another Bigfoot story from a grandparent. My family is nuts. Well, that's two Sasquatch encounters in 24 years. How about that, eh? At least this time, I wasn't about to get snatched by some hairy hobo that didn't wear deodorant. I hope that this email finds you well. Sincerely, James. Again, thank you, James, for taking the time to send this one in. Now, listen, folks, if you're interested in the other encounters that James has sent in that he kept referring to his experiences back in 2000, I'll put the links to them in the video description below. In the first email that James sent, he and his friend Joel were hunting, and they had their deer stolen by a Bigfoot. It was a pretty intense story. Also, at the end of that story, James mentioned that his grandfather also had a story about Bigfoot, which he later sent in, and that is the second email. So if you want to listen to those, check the video description below. I will put the links in there. Also, James, listen, could you go ahead and send in that story from Grandma? Because now I'm on the edge of my seats. I love the older stories. I love stories that come from older people and set in times before all this technology. I think they're important that we get those before they disappear. All right, everyone. Well, listen, thank you for staying with me all night. I think this is going to bring us to the end of another journey down into Sasquatch Valley. So listen, until we set out on the trail together again, please always remember, absence of proof is not proof of absence. Thanks for listening.